Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Shakespeare and Company. Can you all hear me at the back? You can. Can you hear me outside? Just put your hands up. Wave at me if you can hear me. Okay, I'll take that on faith. I don't know if you can hear me upstairs. I would ask you to stamp your feet, but this is a 17th century building, so I'll... let's push on before the beams fall in. The first novel from Folio Prize-winning master of the short story, George Saunders, is exactly the book we readers might have expected, by which I mean that in almost every way, form, voice, narrative, our expectations are confounded. Lincoln in the Bardo is an inventive, comic and humane imagining of the night in February 1862 that President Abraham Lincoln, grief-stricken at the death of Willy, his 11-year-old son, spent in a Georgetown cemetery holding his boy's lifeless body. The result is an astonishing book for which the term historical novel just cannot do justice, replete as it is with profound and surprising contemporary resonances. Indeed, perhaps the only unsurprising thing about Lincoln in the Bardo is that, like all of George Saunders' writing, it is suffused with insight into the human condition and has bags of compassion to spare. But don't take my word for it. Take the word of Jonathan Franzen, who said, "He makes the all but impossible look effortless." Or the word of Zadie Smith, who said, "He will be read long after these times have passed." Or indeed of Thomas Pynchon himself, who said, "George Saunders has an astoundingly tuned voice," and called his work graceful, dark, and funny. George Saunders is also the author of 6 collections of short stories, including the Folio Prize-winning National Book Award shortlisted 10th of December, and 2 works of non-fiction, The Braindead Megaphone and Congratulations, By the Way, the text of his graduation address to Syracuse University, where he also teaches fiction. He has received MacArthur and Guggenheim Fellowships, the Penn Malmud Prize for Excellence in the Short Story, and was recently elected to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. We are truly delighted to have him with us tonight at the end of what sounds like a grueling but rewarding book tour. Please welcome Mr. George Saunders to Shakespeare and Company.
Hi. Hello, thank you so much for being here tonight. Isn't it an amazing space, this sacred place that's been dedicated to thinking and freedom and brotherhood and sisterhood for all these years? So thank you so much for coming. We have kind of a special night planned for you. So let me start by thanking Shakespeare and Company for having me here. It's kind of a lifelong dream to be here. And so let's see. Okay, so this is my first published book, but not my first novel, actually. First published novel, but not my first novel. So I want to tell you, many years ago, my wife and I met in Syracuse University, and their romantic Syracuse, New York ambiance. If you've been there, you're laughing right now. And we got engaged in 3 weeks and married about 4 or 5 months later, pregnant on the honeymoon. And very, you know, it's like Johnny Cash said, we got married in a fever. And then we looked up and we realized we had no money at all. We were broke. And we had a couple of daughters and still had no money. So at one point, a friend of mine got married in Mexico. And so I thought, well, you know, I'll go to the wedding. And I came back and I said to my wife, this is going to be the best novel ever. You are sitting on a gold mine. It had a radical Catholic priest. There was a male model slash surfer. You know, this is it. So I said, just let me run with this for a year, you know. So a year went by. I was working full-time, drinking a pot of coffee every day and sometimes a bottle of Boone's Farm at night, if you know what that is. Yeah, exactly. She knows what it is. So at the end, you know, I had this 700-page book. And in the way that writers will, I said, honey, if you have a few minutes, you want to take a read through it, I think you're going to be very excited. So just to give you some idea of this book's literary merits, the title was La Boda de Eduardo, which I think means like Ed's wedding or something like that. So I gave it to my wife and I kind of, you know, lingered outside the doorway and waited for her reaction. And about, honestly, 10 minutes later, I looked in. She was maybe on page 6 and she was sitting like this. With her head in her hands, and she kind of knew what that had cost our family, you know. So after that, I was a little shy of the novel and didn't write one for many years. But then a few months after that incident, we were up in Washington, D.C., and there's this thing called the Rock Creek Parkway that runs by a cemetery. And my wife's cousin gestured up at this hillside and at this one crypt, and she said, that's where Willie Lincoln was buried in 1862 for 3 years. And then she added this little strange detail that I almost couldn't believe at the time, which is that Lincoln had been so heartsick about his son's death that he actually went into the crypt on several occasions, it was said in the newspapers, to hold the body or to somehow interact. So that really, you know, was so moving and so deep. And I kind of thought, oh, that should be a book, you know. But I had a writing teacher who had told us that if a young writer could tell the difference between the story she should write and the story she should think about writing, she could save herself like 15 years. And that seemed to me at the time like one I couldn't write. It was a little too, you know, too emotional and too straight. So I just kept putting it off. And over the years, you know, wrote collections of stories and essays and all that. And every time I would start to feel artistically happy, that little book would kind of come out of the shadows and go like, come on, Lincoln, it's so cool, you know. And I just kept pushing it off. And finally, in 2012, I'd written this book called 10th of December, and it was done. And I was in that kind of weird period where it's about 3 or 4 months before the book comes out, and your energy is kind of anticipatory about that. And I just thought of that book again, and I thought, oh, God, I don't know. And I kind of, you know, had this little argument with myself about why I wouldn't write it. And the reasons were like, well, first of all, it's too potentially beautiful, you know, it's too straight, it's too much about love and loss and grief and everything that actually concerns you in your real life, so don't write that, you know. But it was a little scary, actually, and so I kind of felt myself to be at a bit of an artistic crossroads, like either you stick with the old tricks and try to make sure you don't screw up, or you kind of, you know, risk everything. So about 3 months in, it was going pretty well, and I wrote a writer friend of mine. I said, you know, this is either the best thing I've ever written or a real career ender. And he said, don't forget, it could be both. You know, yeah. So anyway, that is the book that came to be. Yeah, a lot of writers in the crowd, I can tell. So that turned into Lincoln and the Bardo. So it's a very odd book. If you look at it, it looks like hundreds of monologues with the attributions coming after the monologues. It's narrated. It's all in one night. Most of the narrators are ghosts. I kind of considered making Lincoln the narrator, and then kind of, that's, you know, 4 score and 7 minutes ago, I did come into yon graveyard, and so we did not do that. And then at one point, there was so many ghosts that it was feeling a little bit like, you know, kind of a little gratuitous, and that same writing teacher told me once that he said, now, George, in your writing career, you only get 3 dream sequences. So don't use them up, you know. So at one point, I felt in this book, it needed a little bit of historical grounding. So one of the other things the book has is some verbatim historical quotes from history books. So it's, in a sense, it kind of looks like a play when you look at it on the page. So it turns out it's almost impossible to read from alone. So we are so fortunate tonight. I started this tour February 12th. Haven't been home since. We did 24 cities in 26 days in the U.S. and I think even a faster pace here in Europe, in England and Ireland, and here in France. So in San Francisco, when we started, we had this wonderful group, theater troupe called Word for Word, a kind of legendary American group of actors. They started us off in San Francisco. And also that night, we had a virtual reality presentation by the talented director, Graham Sack. So happy that both of those great entities are here tonight. So if you haven't seen the virtual reality, I think it's going to be shown, I don't know where, do we know where? Somewhere here.
I'll pop back after.
Okay, this is Graham, and he'll pop back. So I really, it's a beautiful, very moving film if you get a chance. And now we're going to have a reading from Word for Word. So this is really going to be a lovely opportunity. So there's a little bit of kind of prep. So let me just, you're going to have to go into the theater of the imaginary with me here. All right, so we're going to pick this up at about chapter 43, which is about 150 pages in. In this scene, Lincoln has just been into the crypt, and kind of surprising himself, he actually holds his son's body, takes it out of the coffin and holds it, puts it back, and then he leaves, and he's feeling very confused about what's just happened, and he knows he should leave, but somehow he isn't quite done, so he can't quite go. So country boy that he is, he kind of settles, he sits down cross-legged in the grass, and is just kind of sitting there on this cold February night. And then two ghosts who just witnessed this very strange holding come flying over, and they see him there, and they decide to try to lure him back to the crypt for a kind of more proper goodbye. So, and Willy, meanwhile, both in body and spirit, is back at the crypt, being minded by this kind of grouchy old guy called the Reverend. Now, as if that's not enough, one of the conventions of this world that I kind of stumbled on was that if we're sitting here in this ancient sacred place, and let's say a ghost of some 1952 young novelist has stayed here all along, and she decides to settle into your body, and as she does that, she gains access to your thought stream. So she can basically read your mind, and she can actually ventriloquize outward. So just while you're here, just keep your thoughts very clean. But so in this scene, these two ghosts are going to come out, notice Lincoln, be on either side of him, and then decide to actually co-inhabit with him. They're actually going to enter his body, and they're both going to sit cross-legged just as he is, and then we're going to sort of hear some of Lincoln's thoughts. Okay, so let me now bring our actors on stage, if I could. So let me step over to this microphone, get out of the way. All right, so let me just run through. Playing Lincoln is going to be Velina Brown. Velina, are you there somewhere? Playing Willy Lincoln is Gia Taylor. Yeah, hi. Thank you so much. And then playing Hans Vollman is going to be Joel Mullinnex. Joel.
Hi. Thank you for coming.
And then we have our historical Roger Bevins will be Sheila Balter. Sheila. We're going to have to get a bigger stage. And then we're going to have some help on the historical voices, Kehinde, Koyejo, and Edris, Cooper-Anifowoshe. Thank you so much. Okay, so let me also just say this: these wonderful actors are a part of Word for Word. They're performing in All Aunt Hager's Children by the wonderful American writer Edward P. Jones. This production is March 27th to the 28th at the American School of Paris. Reservations are required by March 23rd at www.americanlibraryparis.org. And I've heard wonderful things about it. It's supposed to be an absolutely mesmerizing show, so I urge you to see it. All right, so let's see. What else do I have to introduce here? Okay, so let me just explain. The ghost, Hans, is a ghost who was a printer. You have to age him up a bit. He's, you know, a 65-year-old guy who had an arranged marriage with a beautiful young woman. And on the wedding night, he kind of got wind of the fact that she actually wasn't all that into him because she was so much younger. She sort of registered distaste, and he, being a great gentleman, decided that he wouldn't push the issue, and they didn't consummate the marriage. So 3 or 4 months passed by, and his young wife was kind of moved by his kindliness and his consideration. So let's say on a Wednesday afternoon, she sent him a note that basically said, "Tomorrow night, it's on." And so he went to work very happy about that, as you can imagine. And at work, he died. Wah, wah, wah. Yeah, it's that kind of a book. So if you could help me. Now, in this world, one of the rules of this afterlife called the Bardo is that whatever excesses you are involved in life, whatever neuroses or passions or obsessions, when you die, you might actually get a physical manifestation of those things. So in this case, Hans is a little disappointed about his marital situation. So his manifestation is, help me picture, he's naked. He has a tremendously large erection, about the size of a small dog. Thank you so much. The audition process is, oh, you got it. And so then playing the Roger Bevins is a suicide who he was sort of unlucky at love, and he killed himself. And just as his life was ending, he had this revelation that we all have from time to time, that the world is so beautiful, actually, just made perfectly for our pleasure. And he sort of seized up and doesn't want to go on to death. So he's stuck in this in-between state called the Bardo, and his physical manifestation is he has hundreds of extra sensory organs like ears and nose and mouth, and he's constantly gathering things to him to try to, in that last instant, enjoy the physical world just a little bit more. Okay, and I think that's it. When you hear the gentleman, that refers to Abraham Lincoln. So I think we're going to give you a little bit of Lincoln and the Bardo, and we'll start for you now. Thank you. And I'll be your narrator.
I'm going to share the mic with Joe.
Okay, sure.
That's why I was
just say it. Yeah. Chapter 43.
We found the gentleman, as had been described to us, near Bellingweather. Husband, father, shipwright.
Sitting cross-legged and defeated in a patch of tall grass.
As we approached, he lifted his head from his hands and heaved a great sigh. He might have been in that moment a sculpture on the theme of loss. Shall we?
Mr. Vollman said. I hesitated. The Reverend would not approve, I said.
The Reverend is not here.
He said.
44.
In order to occupy the greatest percentage of the gentleman's volume, I lowered myself into his lap and sat cross-legged, just as he was sitting.
The two now comprised one sitting man, Mr. Vollman's greater girth somewhat overflowing the gentleman, his massive member existing wholly outside the gentleman, pointing up at the moon.
It was quite something. Quite something in there. Bevins, come in, I called out. This is not to be missed.
I went in, assuming the same cross-legged posture. And the three of us
were one,
so to speak.
45.
There was a touch of prairie about the fellow.
Yes.
Like stepping into a summer barn at night.
Or a musty plains office where some bright candle still burns.
Vast, windswept, new, sad.
Spacious, curious, tomb-minded.
Back slightly out.
Right boot chafing.
The recent entry of the youthful Mr. Bevins now caused the gentleman a mild thought swerve back to a scene from his own wild youth.
A soft-spoken,
but retrograde, dirty cheeks, kind eyes.
Lass, leading him shyly down a muddy path, nettles accruing on her swaying green skirt.
As in his mind at the time, a touch of shame rose up, having to do with his sense that this girl was
not really fair game.
I.e.
was more beast than lady.
I.e.
did not even know how to read.
Becoming aware of that which he was remembering, the man's face reddened. We could feel it reddening at the thought that he was
in the midst of this tragic circumstance.
Remembering
such a sordid incident.
And he hurriedly directed his
our
mind elsewhere,
so as to leave this inappropriate thought behind.
46.
Tried to see
his boy's face.
Couldn't.
Tried to hear
the boy's
laugh.
Couldn't.
Attempted to recall some particular incident involving the boy.
In hope this might.
First time we fitted him with a suit.
Thus thought the gentleman. This did the trick.
First time we fitted him with a suit. He looked down at the trousers and then up at me, amazed, as if to say,
Father, I am wearing grown-up pants.
Shirtless, barefoot, pale round belly like an old man's, then the little cuffed shirt, and buttoning it up. Goodbye, little belly. We are inshirting you now.
Inshirting? I do not believe that is even a word, Father.
I tied the little tie, spun him around for a look. We have dressed up a wild savage, looks like, I said. He made the
growling face.
His hair stuck straight up. His cheeks were red. Racing around that store just previous, he had
knocked over a rack of socks.
The tailor, complicit, brought out the little jacket with much pomp.
Then the shy, boyish smile as I slid the jacket on him.
Say,
he said,
don't I look fine, Father?
Then no thought at all for a while. And we just looked about us.
Bare trees, black
against the dark blue sky.
Little jacket, little jacket. Little jacket.
The phrase sounded in our head. A star flickered off, then on.
Same one he is wearing back in there now. Same little jacket. But he who is wearing it is
I so do not want it to be true. Broken. Pale, broken thing. Why will it not work? What magic word made it work? Who is the keeper of that word? What did it profit him to switch this one off? What a contraption it is. How did it ever run? What spark ran it? Grand little machine. Set up just so, receiving the spark, it jumped to life. What put out that spark? What a sin it would be. Who would dare ruin such a marvel? Hence his murder anathema. God forbid I should ever commit such a grievous...
Something then troubling us.
We ran one hand roughly over our face.
As if attempting to suppress a notion just arising.
This effort not proving successful.
The notion washed over us.
47.
Young Willy Lincoln was laid to rest on the day that the casualty list from the Union victory at Fort Donelson were publicly posted, an event that caused a great shock among the public at the time, the cost in life being unprecedented thus far in the war.
In Setting the Record Straight, Memoir, Error, and Evasion by Jason Tom, Journal of American History.
The details of the losses were communicated to the president even as young Willie lay under embalmment.
In Lincoln's Lost Angel by Simon Iverness.
More than 1,000 troops on both sides were killed.
And 3 times that number wounded. It was a most bloody fight.
A young Union soldier told his father, so devastating to his company, that despite the victory, he remained
sad, lonely, and downhearted. Only 7.
Only 7 of the 85 men in his unit survived.
In Team of Rivals, The Political Genius of Abraham Lincoln by Doris Kearns Goodwin.
The dead at Donelson, sweet Jesus, heaped and piled like threshed wheat. One on top of two, on top of three.
I walked through it after with a bad feeling. Lord, it was me done that, I thought.
In These Battle Memories by First Lieutenant Daniel Brower.
The dead lay as they had fallen, in every conceivable shape, some grasping their guns as though they were in the act of firing, while others, with a cartridge in their icy grasp, were in the act of loading. Some of the countenances wore a peaceful, glad smile, while on others rested a fiendish look of hate. It looked as though each countenance was the exact counterpart of the thoughts that were passing through the mind when the death messenger laid them low. Perhaps that noble-looking youth, with his smiling, upturned face, with his glossy ringlets matted with his own life blood, felt a mother's prayer stealing over his senses as his young life went out. Near him lay a young husband with a prayer for his wife and little one yet lingering on his lips. Youth and age, virtue and evil were represented on those ghastly countenances.
Before us lay the charred and blackened remains of some who had been burnt alive.
They were wounded too badly to move,
and the fierce elements consumed them.
In The Civil War Years, a day-to-day chronicle of the life of a nation, account of Corporal Lucius W. Barber, 15th Illinois Infantry.
I had never seen a dead person before. Now, I saw my fill. One poor lad had frozen solid in the posture of looking down aghast at his wound, eyes open.
Some of his insides had spilled out and made there on his side under a thin coat of ice, a blur of purple and red. At home on my dressing table was a holy card of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, and this fellow looked like that. Only his bulge of red and purple was lower and larger and off to one side, and him gazing down at it in horror.
From That Terrible Glory, a collection of Civil War letters from the men who fought it, compiled and edited by Brian Bell and Libby Trust.
And mother, fire had swept through the frozen dead and hurt where they lay. We found one still kicking among them and was able to bring him back still alive, not even knowing which side he was on. So burnt was he, and naked except for one leg of his pants. I never did hear how he made out, but it did not look hopeful for that poor devil.
In Letters of an Illinois Soldier, edited by Sam Westfall, account of Private Edward Gates, Company F, 15th Illinois Volunteer Infantry.
Two or three of us
would grab a fellow
and haul him away just as we found him.
As it was cold and the bodies were completely froze.
That day I learned a person can get used to anything.
Soon it all seemed normal to us.
And we even joked about it.
Making up names for each, depending on how it looked.
There was bent over.
There was shocked.
This was half boy.
From Oh to Be Home Again with You, Letters from Fallen Warriors, Daniel Spence, editor.
We found two little fellers holding hands. Couldn't been more than 14, 15 apiece. As if they had decided to pass through that dark portal together.
Unpublished Civil War correspondence of Andrew Stark by permission of his family.
How many more dead do you intend to make, sir, afore you is done? 1 minute there was our little Nate on that bridge with the fishbowl. And where is that boy now? And what is it, who is it, called him hither? In that notice he saw down to Orbeez, well, sir, that was your name he saw upon it. Abraham Lincoln.
In Country Letters to President Lincoln, letter from Robert Hansworthy, Boonesboro, Maryland. Chapter 48.
He is just one, and the weight of it about to kill me. Have exported this grief some 3,000 times so far to date. A mountain of boys. Someone's boys. Must keep on with it. May not have the heart for it. One thing to pull the lever when blind to the result. But here lies one dear example of what I accomplish by the orders I... May not have the heart for it. What to do? Call a heart? Toss down the hole, the loss hole, those 3,000? Sue for peace? Become great course-reversing fool? King of indecision? Laughing stock for the ages, waffling hick? Slim Mr. Turnabout? It's out of control. Who is doing it? Who caused it? Whose arrival on the scene began it? What am I doing? What am I doing here? Everything nonsense now. Those mourners came up, hands extended, sons intact, wearing on their faces enforced sadness masks to hide any sign of their happiness, which went on. They could not hide how alive they were yet with it. With their happiness, at the potential of their still living sons. Until lately, I was one of them, strolling, whistling through the slaughterhouse, averting my eyes from the carnage, able to laugh and dream and hope because it had not yet happened to me, to us. Trap. horrible trap. At one's birth, it is sprung. Some last day must arrive when you will need to get out of that body. Bad enough when we bring a baby here. The terms of the trap are compounded. That baby must also depart. All pleasures should be tainted by that knowledge. But hopeful, dear us, we forget. Lord, what is this? All of this walking about, trying, smiling, bowing, joking, this sitting down at table, pressing of shirts, tying of ties, shining of shoes, planning of trips, singing of songs in the bath. When he is to be left out there, is a person to nod, dance, reason, walk, discuss as before? A parade passes. He can't rise and join. Am I to run after it? Take my place, lift my knees high, wave a flag, blow a horn? Was he dear or not? Then let me be happy no more.
Chapter 49.
It was quite cold, being in the gentleman. We were, for the first time in...
ever so long.
Quite cold ourselves.
He sat, distraught and shivering, seeking about for any consolation.
He must either be in a happy place, or some null place by now.
Thought the gentleman.
In either case, no longer suffering. Suffered so terribly at the end. The racking cough, the trembling, the vomiting, the pathetic attempts to keep the mouth wiped with a shaky hand, the way his panicked eyes would steal up and catch mine as if to say,
Is there really nothing, Papa, you can do?
And in his mind, the gentleman stood, we stood with him on a lonely plain, screaming at the top of our lungs. Quiet then, and a great weariness.
All over now. He is either in joy or nothingness. So why grieve? The worst of it, for him, is over. Because I loved him so and am in the habit of loving him. And that love must take the form of fussing and worrying and doing. Only there's nothing left to do. Free myself of this darkness as I can, remain useful, not go mad, think of him when I do, as being in some bright place, free of suffering, resplendent in a new mode of being.
Thus thought the gentleman, thoughtfully combing a patch of grass with his hand.
Chapter 50. And Lord, the fellow was low. He was attempting to formulate a goodbye in some sort of positive spirit, not wishing to enact that final departure in gloom, in case it might be felt somehow by the lad, even as he told himself
that the lad was now past all feeling.
But all within him was sadness, guilt, and regret. And he could find little else, so he lingered.
Hoping for some comforting notion to arise.
Upon which he might expand.
But nothing came.
Low. Colder than before and sadder. And when he directed his mind outward, seeking the comfort of his life out there, and the encouragement of his future prospects, and the high regard in which he was held, no comfort was forthcoming, but on the contrary.
He was not, it seemed, well thought of, or succeeding in much of anything at all.
Thank you so much. It's so beautiful. And I also want to thank, this is directed by Jim Cave. Thank you so much for your generosity and best of luck with the show. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jim. Good luck. Three hard-boiled eggs.
Well, how to follow that? I think that was a fascinating choice, I think, for the dramatic reading as well, because I think it shows us the both the very intimate canvas you were working on, but also the very kind of broad historical canvas, which is perhaps the canvas all presidents perhaps have to work on, have to negotiate between in their lives. When I was deciding how to structure our conversation, I wrote a whole list of questions, things I wanted to talk with you about, and then when I started dividing them into two groups, they kind of fell quite easily into two groups. One I kind of labelled Lincoln, and the other one I kind of labelled Bardo. So it sort of seemed it seemed very appropriate for the title. So let's begin with Lincoln. So you said this this story of Lincoln going to visit Willy's crypt had something that you'd heard about 20 years before writing the novel. But I was wondering as well, you said you started it in 2012, and this was, of course, at a very particular moment in American history, and I think it was sort of after the first mandate of President Obama, who was a president who evoked Lincoln quite a lot in his rhetoric and in his speeches, I think deliberately and also maybe unconsciously as well. Do you think it was partly the spirit of the times as well that pushed you to write this novel at this moment?
It might have been. You know, one of the things that I loved about the 8 years we had with President Obama was that I, for the first time in my life, I actually thought, well, we could maybe get there. We could maybe actually do what the Constitution told us to do, which was to treat total equality as a birthright, not something that one group was giving to somebody else as an act of charity, but you were born with total luminous equality. That's what, so I could feel, especially I teach at Syracuse, and I could see in the young people I was meeting that a lot of the stupidity that my generation was sort of born into and trained in had sort of actually receded. So I think when I first thought of this book, I thought, wouldn't it be lovely to write a book about the this big turn in American history when we first started to really think we could fulfill the potential, and then it would be finished when we actually did it. That was kind of the thought anyway. So imagine my surprise.
And I suspect we'll get on to the cause of this surprise towards the end of our discussion, but I'd like to rest with Lincoln, the figure, for now. I'm fascinated by how you as a writer got to know Lincoln as a historical figure, but also as a character. How did you find your way into his thoughts, into his voice?
Yeah, you know, part of it, I mean, I'm sure there are a lot of young writers here, and part of the game is it really is it's a trick of the eye in a certain way. Nobody knows Lincoln. Nobody knew Lincoln when he was walking around. That was one of the things people said. He's an incredibly generous, kind person, but he's not. He's very private, and so I think part of what you do is you kind of, you learn enough about the historical facts and about the outline of the person that makes kind of a like a jello mold, essentially, that you have to sort of stay within. Then what you do is you take your own phenomenon, in your own, in my case, the love I have for my children, the self-doubts I have, the ambition I have, and you kind of make that into, you melt it down and make it into a jello and you put it into that mold. So the only real game, it's not really to be faithful to Lincoln or make a true Lincoln. It's to make the illusion of a Lincoln so that the book will move the reader. That's right. You know, so for me, that inciting incident of the father holding the son, everything was in that. And I always kept a picture of Willy above my desk just to remind myself that that's what it was about, and I didn't want to dishonor him or his memory. So then you think, well, what's the point of a novel? It's actually not to get everything right. It's not to catalog a historical period. It's not to show the truth about the Civil War or even the geography of a graveyard. It's to kind of put the reader into that state where she goes, shit, whoa, you know, where that kind of irreducible, non-conceptual state of wonder that we get into after a work of art that maybe lasts 10 minutes or an hour, that actually is, that's the only end game. Mm-hmm. So then it all became a little bit of, I would say, honorable gamesmanship. Mm-hmm. So for example, one thing I learned was if you want to do Lincoln, it's kind of like doing Jesus, and it's very, very risky. So you want to do it for as short a time as possible, you know? So you don't keep him on stage for 400 pages. You let him come in and you get, thank you, Abe, move off your go, you know? The other thing was that there had to be, a lot of the thought wasn't so much what would Lincoln do, but what would any father and husband and middle-aged dude do if he had just held the body of a loved one. You know, so you can kind of, it's almost like that old, in the States there was a thing, a commercial where a guy said, I'm not a doctor, but I play one on TV. It's kind of like that, you know, yeah.
And yet, I mean, you say you didn't, you know, it was sort of the historical Lincoln wasn't necessarily sort of driving you as a novelist. And yet, in a way, history gifted you this wonderful sort of narrative coincidence, let's say, on the day that, I think it was the day that Willy was laid to rest, was the day that the casualty lists from the Union victory at Fort Donelson were publicly posted. So you have this, and these are one of the early signs, from what I understand, of the level of death that, yes, that we would have from the Civil War. So even though you didn't feel constrained by this history, you were gifted this.
You were guided by it. That's right. It's the whole Lincoln story is so biblical, you know, because here's this guy who comes out of nowhere. His election to the presidency guarantees the South's going to secede. He can't get him back. The war expands from a kind of a theoretical thing about Union to the most important anti-genocidal battle and ever fought on the continent, you know. And then at the very moment of victory, he dies on Good Friday. You know, it's unbelievable. So I think part of it was to say, okay, I know some facts. I know that this was the moment where, you know, people, it's amazing to read the letters. They said, oh, this will be over in a couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll make a show of force in the South. We'll think better of it. And then right about this time, they're getting these weird reports by telegraph. Mm-hmm. They sometimes, I'm sure, thought it was an error. 3,000 dead in one day, 10,000 dead. So everybody's starting to realize that this is a Chinese thumb trap of a war that nobody's going to get out cheaply. And then you think, okay, so in the middle of that, you're the guy who's kind of known as a screw-up. Mm. You know, he was a corrupt government. He was having hundreds of people into the White House to have meetings with him as the war was going downhill, just civilians. You're that guy. Everyone's making fun of you. Mm-hmm. You're a hick. You know, you're somebody who doesn't know how to do the job. Then your son dies. So I kept thinking of how sorrow, like if you are so heavy laden with sorrow that you can't even keep up the pretense of having control of your life, you don't even have any relation to control, there's a kind of a beatific state that can happen, I think, at least from little examples I've had in my life where the stuffing gets kicked out of you and suddenly all your illusions fall away. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the state he was in. Of course, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But then you see a turn in him after this thing, and suddenly, my view is his empathy kind of broadened. Mm-hmm. And instead of just thinking about winning the war for his side and the Northern soldiers, he started thinking about the millions of Americans who were being enslaved. Mm-hmm. He really started thinking about them, you know, maybe for the first time. His sympathy even extended to the South, you know. So you do get to use those things, but I'm not sure if my interpretation is right. Uh-huh. My interpretation is he got so deeply sad that he got crazy wise. Mm-hmm. And then he was able to become basically in what I would consider in the Buddhist tradition like a bodhisattva. Mm-hmm. Suddenly he was doing for everybody, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I mean there's a moment where he's described as, I think, the saddest man in the world.
Yeah.
And I guess it's that moment when sort of your feet sort of touch the solid ground of absolute desperation.
I think
that
so. We've all had those moments. I think mostly for me it's happened when someone I love has died. But I think it also happens when you fall in love or when you have a child. And you see that most of your life you're going through the world with a kind of habitual way of thinking that isn't quite correct. It's not actually enough. You know, you're out on the street in Paris and you're walking along and your mind does this adjustment to say, I'm on a street, those are trees, those are people, that's a dog. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's true. It's a good way of doing business. But when you're hit with a huge loss, that drops. You go, holy shit, I'm dying. We're all dying. We're all conditional. We're all these crazy consciousness-bearing machines that go around. I mean, the world is way beyond our ability to grasp it. So I think with grief, we sometimes get a little glimpse, and then the walls come back up. I think art also, we get a little glimpse. If we read something or hear something or see a wonderful production, our eyes open just for a minute, and then they close again, but that experience is actually sacramental because it infuses every other minute of your life with this kind of awe. You know, that's the idea anyway.
And so you talked about this Buddhist conception, and of course the Bardo, it's a concept from the Buddhist philosophy. Now, I guess, I mean, first of all, I suppose one would imagine in a story about Lincoln that if we're going to talk about the afterlife or sort of in-between state, one might go the Judeo-Christian route that would have been so prevalent in the United States at that time and still is today. And yet, so obviously there's a very deliberate reason why you went the Buddhist route, and I'm interested to hear about that.
Well, my wife and I had been kind of aspiring Buddhists for 15 years, and one of the things that it intrigued me about the Tibetan tradition is, one, that I don't understand it very well, so I love the idea that I could, if I said Bardo, I would always be befuddling myself because I don't quite know it. If I said purgatory, I kind of know what it is. It's like a hard bench, and you go sit there until the end of days, until God comes to get you. So part of it was I thought, you know, whatever death is, we don't know what it is. And if a meteor hits us right now, we're all going to be very surprised that, you know, I mean, maybe the surprise will be that there actually is a St. Peter. You know, we don't know. But so part of it was just to confuse myself. But also some of the Tibetan tradition is so interesting. I mean, they say things that make a lot of sense and yet are totally terrifying. For example, what they say is, when you're in this state that we're in right now, we've got this mind-body combo, and as neurotic and full of wildness as our minds are now, they say, well, you're lucky because in this state they're dampened by the body. Kind of like, you ain't seen nothing yet, you wait. When you die, they say your mind is like a wild horse, and all the time you've been on earth, that wild horse is tied to a post. Well, when you die, that rope gets cut. And your habits of mind that you are enacting right this minute get supersized. Mm-hmm. So if you're a jealous person, you get really jealous. You know, if you're a happy person, you might get really happy. But I mean, I'm simplifying, but that was intriguing to me. The idea that if you wanted to find out about the afterlife, you could look at right now, you know.
And just as from a kind of composition perspective, I'm fascinated. So earlier on, you talked about sort of the things that happen in the Bardo and things that don't. And I was wondering, how much did you follow sort of a fixed conception of what the Bardo was? Or from a kind of writer's perspective, did you set yourself certain rules, or did you allow it to be sort of a complete free-for-all?
Right. Early on, I thought, wouldn't it be great to write a whole novel that totally enacts the Tibetan Book of the Dead? And I thought, yeah, except then I'd have to study it for 50 years, you know, and I still wouldn't be able. So I just kind of took it as a spur to the imagination. Mm-hmm. One thing that it says in there that's very interesting is that if you say you're a strong Christian, and you pray and you meditate and you think in the Christian symbols, then those symbols will, of course, follow you into the afterlife. And you'll see these very vivid, you'll see Jesus and you'll see Mary. If you're a Buddhist, you'll see Buddhist iconography. Mm-hmm. You know, I guess if you're a pro wrestling fan, you know, there you go. But that to me was, again, at some point I said, you know, I am not going to make a catalog here, but I can use this stuff in that sort of almost selfish, distortive, artistic way to try to make beauty. So that the one thing that really spoke to me was the idea that that the Bardo is sort of a transactional state where you actually can get out of it if you have the wherewithal. Mm-hmm. So in this world, a lot of the dead people, their big problem is they don't know they're dead. So they're kind of in denial. And in the ghost literature, there's this kind of riff that says these mediums will say to a ghost, what year is it? And the ghost will say, you know, 1724. And you're like, no, it's 2017. And you show them a newspaper and they go, oh, okay. And then they go to heaven, you know. So that was kind of an interesting idea. Yeah.
As a kind of sidestep on the subject of ghost literature, I've heard you speak before about your admiration for A Christmas Carol. And obviously that's an example of ghosts being used to tell a morality tale. And I think now the moral or morals at work in Lincoln and the Bardo are perhaps more complex than the sort of good-bad dichotomy that the Dickens was working with. But was that your sort of your admiration for this book?
Oh, yeah, very much. You know, there's a scene where Jacob Marley shows up and he's got all those cash boxes on, which is kind of like the erect member, except a little naughtier. But yeah, no, definitely. That book, I taught it last year at Syracuse, and it is, like, I think it's a perfect work of art. Mm. It's so, it's like a little beautiful machine. Mm. Really wonderful. Yeah.
It's also a kind of a strange challenge for a writer to set as well, of this kind of... You begin a book in which essentially all but one of your principal characters are already dead. Yeah. So the possibility of narrative arcs or character development or things like that, you're sort of did you consciously set yourself this challenge?
Was that no, I you didn't. And with? About halfway through, I went, oh God, you know, because what happens is if there's no consequence for these dead people, then there's no story. So then, in a weird way, you know, sometimes the problem of a book. Starts with you. You say, oh my God, this is a problem. I'm no good. You know, I should have gone to law school. Oh, I'm a total loser, you know. But then if you keep working, the problem passes from you into the realm of the character. So in this case, the problem that the two main narratives had no causal, you know, crossover became what the characters were, the ghosts were wondering about. Mm-hmm. And it became very touching. They were kind of like, oh, you know, we seem to not be what we were before. Mm-hmm. We feel kind of useless. We feel like we have no impact on anything. That's sad. It's depressing. So they kept worrying, is there any way that we can be meaningful to living people? Mm-hmm. And in the end, that question kept getting answered, then opened up again. And I think it actually doesn't get really answered until the last 20 pages. Mm-hmm. So that this is, you know, for me, this stage of talking about a book is complicated because my process is very intuitive and very kind of iterative. Like I do a lot of rewriting. And I never think about these things in process except in terms of revising stuff, you know. And the book, it's such a beautiful process because the book is smarter than I am, you know, and by revising it, it goes, okay, let me defer that question to page 300 and I'll ask it again then, you know. So it's kind of a wonderful thing the way it works.
Yeah. And of course, one of the things that writing was setting your book in the Bardo allowed you to do as well. And again, I don't know if this was something which you necessarily set out to do or something that arose while you were writing, was, as you mentioned with the character, so their characteristics in life were sort of exaggerated in death. And that's one of the reasons I think I said in the introduction that it was a very sort of very timely piece, because to me it felt to be a book a lot to do with how we perceive each other, how we perceive ourselves, and how we communicate.
Yes.
And it made me think of, so your essay, which was the title essay of the collection, The Brain Dead Megaphone, which you wrote, was published in the book in 2008, I think you'd written a few years earlier, where you sort of have this sense of the way, particularly in the media, we communicate is this kind of, this shouting at each other, this kind of high volume, low, lacking in subtlety. Mm-hmm. And it seems interesting that to me, because you have all life is in the Bardo, you have people from all different levels of society, all different conditions, and the way they perceive, the way that they're physically manifested seems to represent also the way they might perceive each other. I mean, did you set out with a specific sort of social motive, or was that something that arose?
My model of writing, I'm kind of, I didn't publish a first book till I was 37. And I had that very, real experience of seeing how narrow my little talent wedge was. And it turned, what I found out about myself was if I have a lot of preconceptions or thematic ideas, it just dies on the vine, you know. So what I have to do is kind of say, all right, the book, I have three sort of mantras that I always recite. One is Donald Barthelme, who said, the writer is that person who, embarking on a task, has no idea what to do. Mm-hmm. That's different. The second one, excuse me, there are kids here? Yeah, let's just say they're not. actually, it's nicer if we don't. We'll say, poet Gerald Stern said, if you set out to write a poem about two dogs making love, and you write a poem about two dogs making love, then you wrote a poem about two dogs making love. Mm-hmm. Right? So, and then Einstein said, no worthy problem is ever solved on the plane of its original conception. Mm-hmm. So what those all add up to is if you have a big artistic ambition and you do exactly that thing, you're a drag. Mm-hmm. You know, you've just failed your audience. So the trick is to get into it and then let the book start talking to you in some way, right? So that's the ultimate goal. Mm-hmm. What's scary about that and good about it is you can kind of set thematics aside. Mm-hmm. You can set politics aside. And I guess the idea is if you're a moral, ethical thinker. If you live politically, if you have those things, will all find their way in. But they find their way in through this beautiful side door, which is your, I guess it's your subconscious or your whatever you want to call it. So this book is for me hard to talk about because I really just was trying to do a lot of stagecraft. Mm-hmm. Like, can I get Lincoln in and out of the crypt? Can I get, you know, that? And then as that was happening, it's like these thematic ideas are these little forest creatures, and they don't come out if you look right at them. You know, you have to concentrate on, okay, it's 11:36, so the temperature just dropped, and then they start coming out, and you're like, oh, here they come. You know, don't look at them directly. Yeah.
In a way, you sort of, if you set out to write a State of the Nation novel, you're never going to do something which rings true as a State of the Nation.
Yeah, I'm not. I mean, I tell my students that this, I have a very passionate idea about this intuitive approach, but I know people who they plan out everything. So it's not, it certainly isn't rigid, but for me, I found out a long time ago that if I have the slightest idea of what I want the book to be, it won't. Mm-hmm. So I mean, for me, I have this idea that you start with the smallest little seed crystal of an idea, and then there's an act of faith that says, if it's interesting to me, and I start polishing it, it's going to sprout plot. So I had a story called Sea Oak, and it's a story that I really like of mine. And it started in a mall in Syracuse, and I was walking behind these two kind of working class young women, and they had the big long fake nails, and they were walking along, and I heard, and then one turned to the other one and said, I told that fucker she's gonna fucking kick the fucking shit out of fucking cunt. Like, what? And so I kind of moved in, and their friend said, I know. You know, fucking shit, fucking shit, and it went on. So I just stalked these two girls through the mall, you know, and then I got home and I just tried to imitate what they had done there. Mm-hmm. And I did that for about 4 days, just refining it, making it funnier, making it punchier. And at one point, one of the girls said, I don't know, Aunt Bernie. I'm like, who's Aunt Bernie? Well, suddenly you got plot, you know. So that story turns out to be, I mean, now people, it's about class and it's about aspiration. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it started off with just that little thing. Mm-hmm. So that's great. It's also a little scary because, you know, I'm 58 years old and that's my job, you know, is to find little seed crystals and work them over obsessively until they produce plot, you know. You know, the college tuitions are adding up and, you know.
Now, I'm very conscious there's going to be quite a few people who want to ask you a question, so get your question ready. I'll be coming over to you in a moment. But I just, at the beginning of our conversation, you alluded to the current state of political affairs in the United States. And that, I mean, it must be a very strange moment for you to have started the book in 2012 and to have it come out in 2017 with a very different, in a way, when you started it, there was a president which one might say had a similar stature to Lincoln, and as I said earlier, sort of evoked Lincoln quite a bit. And now we have,
don't say it,
quite the opposite. I was just wondering if you could reflect.
When I was home, it's an electrifying moment because those of us who got blasé about democracy have got a little wake-up call, you know. And I think I was shocked, like anyone was. And then I thought, you know what? If your dog bites you in the groin, that's on you. You didn't know your dog, you know. So I'm thinking, okay, as writers, as intellectuals, what's the job? The job is to open up all of our senses like we do and use our art to figure out what the hell's going on and to push back if we feel like pushing back, which I certainly do. And then also, you know, around the States, there's a lot of young artists saying, well, young progressives, we've always believed in empathy and kindness and compassion and mutual curiosity, but now we feel like we have to fight fiercely back without any you know, weakness. Should we fight or should we be empathetic? And I'm like, yeah, that's the best way to fight, you know, to find out what this thing is, what's this force that's going on here. It's not a new thing in American life at all, this idea that we were here and now we're giving equality. That's an old bullshit idea that's been around a long time. So I think it's actually a pretty invigorating time for those of us who maybe were lulled into optimism by the Obama years. Okay, so now it's okay. You know, I think we can do it. I think it's not... too long a period of liberals kind of wailing and gnashing their teeth, and now it's time to go, yeah, that happened. And actually, it shouldn't be surprising. It's not surprising to a lot of people, you know.
And indeed, not surprising. So in rereading The Braindead Megaphone in the context of this, so this was a book that came out in 2008, it's fascinating to feel that all of the seeds are there, whether that be in the essay, The Braindead Megaphone, whether it's in the essay about the border between the United States and Mexico. It's... Yeah, it was fascinating to think, you know, if in a way I had this awful feeling, if people had just read this closer, perhaps
I had that feeling myself. If they'd bought more copies, we wouldn't be in this terrible mess. No, but there, you know, it's being in this beautiful place and in this beautiful city, you know, here you're reminded that there have been generations of people who came here to this building. Why? Because they knew they didn't know enough. Mm-hmm. And they knew that if they didn't know enough, they'd live smaller lives. And not only for them, but for the people around them. Mm-hmm. They live less kindly, compassionate, empathetic lives because they were living out of small projections of a very big world. Mm-hmm. So I think one thing, I covered the Trump campaign for The New Yorker, and one thing I found was, if you want to eliminate the vitriol and the anger and all that and look at it clinically, people who supported Trump, this has been supported in polls, they tend to not actually live around immigrants, people of color, the border, or Muslims. So why do they think the things they do? Projection. Mm-hmm. We all project. That's how we, you know, you think Milwaukee, you make a little brewery or something, you know, some cheese and a beer or something, you know. That's okay. That's human nature. But one of the reasons places like this are so sacred is that people come here to blow the shit out of their projections and get bigger ones. And maybe they blow them up so much they have almost no projections. And I think in the absence of projections, you have love. Mm-hmm. That's actually what you have. Not like hearts and roses, but you have clear vision. And you see every other human being as a luminous soul who's not that much different from you. So if we wanted to get away from the strict right-left opposition, which is a no-win game, what we can say is, let's everybody, if we want to try to persuade somebody, let's hang it on individual human faces, mm-hmm. individual human dreams, actual individuals being humiliated and embarrassed. That's something where when I was on the campaign trail, that was the one place where there was a little wiggle room, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so.
Well, it's impossible for me to follow that, so I'm going to hand it over to the audience. Please do wait for the microphone to get to you. That way everyone outside and upstairs can hear. We have first question, that lady just there.
Those are some good boots.
Congratulations, George, on the book. Not to project onto you, to use your word, but I just want to thank you for all your beautiful short stories and this novel now. It seems to me like you're, I don't know if I speak for everyone, but what I get from your writing is that you, throughout the satire and the even the more touching recent short stories, you are a champion for maintaining innocence and being uncontaminated through maturity. So that's always been moving.
Much.
I mean, that's just my projection onto you. But my question is, could you expand a little bit more through all the polyphony of the book? You said that you focused on the image of Willy as a tuning fork to the emotional core. Mm-hmm. What other voices of people you knew or texts that you might have used as a tuning fork to?
Well, thank you so much for that. I think this goes back a little bit to the intuitive thing, and I always feel like these answers are kind of empty. But basically, when I was trying to make these ghosts, I would just do something like this. It's kind of a form of improv. So we're strongly visualizing, say, where we are in the graveyard. Then we go, oh, there's a ghost at 3 o'clock. Oh, there he is. Then you start, literally, you just start riffing. Is there a voice that's sort of at the back of your throat that you can do? Just do it. And that moment there, which is so subtle, is actually, I think, the thing that makes writing interesting or not. If at that moment you say, there's a ghost at 3 o'clock, let's make sure he critiques patriarchy. then suddenly you're playing a different game. You know, you've got puppet strings on the ghost. But if you just turn to him and go, I just say the voice, just the way you would in improv. Then in writing, the beautiful thing is you can then revise it. Mm-hmm. So you just emit something, and maybe it's a little sloppy. All right, it's okay. Is there anything in there that's interesting? In this book, all the ghosts had one rule, which is they had to be really unhappy with their lives. There's not a happy ghost in the book because they're up in heaven dancing or whatever they do. So that was, it's really just kind of trusting that there is something, you know, it's like the idea that the artistic mind is very vast and very intuitive, and it's smarter than I am, it's funnier, it's nicer, all those things. So in a sense, what we're doing as artists or writers is we're training ourselves to open up that conduit and not mess it up with our controlling hands, you know. Now that's easier said than done. I think I'm sure in acting it's, you know, it's years of practice to try to get in that space. But many of us, when we're young writers, we think it has to do with having big ideas or nice org charts or something. And it may be for some people it does, but for me it was just about saying, you know, I grew up in Chicago on the South Side, and one of the things you could do there to get some credibility was to be funny. To like imitate a teacher was comic gold. So that was improv, you know, or in class when you were trying to be the class clown. If you said something a little too late, it wasn't funny, you know. Or if you said, "Oh, that'll be funny," and then said it, it wouldn't be funny. So that whole kind of thing. It's a very to be able to say, "Yeah, actually, art is an intuitive process." That was kind of the big thing. So innocence and so on. I think you're absolutely right. But what I find is revision is the thing that brings you in touch with your better nature. So the example I always use is you dash off a sentence. Frank was an asshole. Fine. The god of fiction says, "How so?" And you say, Frank was an asshole because he snapped at the young barista. And the god of fiction is a little satisfied, but not much. And he says, "Why do you think he did that?" And we say, Frank snapped at the barista because she reminded him of his wife, his dead wife. Frank snapped at the barista because she reminded him of Emily, his dead wife, gone these 2 years, and he had never felt like himself since. Well, suddenly Frank goes from, you know, he might still be kind of an asshole, but he's an asshole who once loved somebody so much that her loss has made him a mean guy, you know. So now, did I revise that in order to be more compassionate? Not really. I wanted to get rid of that lame old sentence, and then I was honoring the god of fiction who wants specificity and detail. So my thing is, if I want to find out the best self I can be, make up a bunch of people and look at them with that kind of open eyes and revision. It's not that everybody's going to be wonderful, but isn't it the case that when you love somebody in this world, you really just agree to see them, you know? They can come to you and they're terrible, but yeah, all right. It's Melvin. It's old terrible Melvin, you know? I mean, that. So I think there's some form of that in revision, if that, yeah.
Okay, who do we have
next?
That's
my next book, Terrible Melvin.
Got a question.
Yes.
Oh,
I just have a question. After the first time you were in Washington 20 years ago, and heard the story about Lincoln visiting Willy in the crypt, I presume you must have gone back to Oak Hill. Did you go back to like walk around, because it's so vividly rendered?
Yeah, I went back 2 or 3 times, and then the last time I went, I was about halfway through the book, and I'm like, I'm not coming back here anymore, because then you start, you think, this is not the graveyard that I made in the book, you know. It's I did the standard thing where you take a notebook and you write down all the names on the graves, and you know, have a surveying rod, and but then it seemed to me at some point that you have to let go of the real graveyard in order to make a more beautiful one. But the thing I did take was, it's such a, have you been there? I'm sorry, but it's a beautiful place, really, and it's got a lot of there's a lot of hills and low places, and it's really gorgeous. So I went there enough to go to sort of internalize the beauty of the place, and then at some critical moment you have to say, I am making up my own graveyard to serve my own purposes, I guess.
Did you take any names from the
graveyard? I did, yeah. Yeah, I don't know if I took some from there, some from upstate New York, some from California, some from the phone book, actually, at some point. Yeah, it was really, you know, that was really funny to get to a certain point in the book and go, okay, this is now its own thing, and all the rules are. In fact, you know, I had been, as I mentioned, I'd been quoting historical text, like Doris Kearns Goodwin verbatim, and then one day I just had the impulse to make one up. I'm like, yeah, this was before alt facts were a thing. So, but I thought, yeah, you can do that. You can. It's your book. You can do whatever you like, you know. So I made them up, and then there was a whole process of the ones I made up were sort of fancy pants. You know, they were always the best written ones in the book. So then you like dial that down so that hopefully they're indistinguishable from the real ones. And so yeah. So, but all of that is based on the idea that in a work of fiction, you're going for a thrill that can only be gotten by very truthful falsification. You know, so kind of that feeling when you say, I have a ghost story to tell you, and it happened in this very bookstore. And everyone's like, no, it didn't. And you go, yeah, I know, but just pretend, you know. So yeah, yeah.
Okay, we have a question. Just there.
Hi.
I have a question. I was reading an article that you'd written for The New Yorker, another one about recounting your days at Syracuse.
Yes.
And very fond memories of your writing professor. It was Tobias Wolff. And you said in there that he had given you some kind of extremely good advice about writing character dialogue, and it was so good that you couldn't share it there. And I was just wondering if I could put you on the spot and ask you,
There was a footnote that said only at Shakespeare and Company could that, the sacred art. Yeah, that was actually, that article has a lot about Toby, but that guy was Douglas Unger, was a teacher of mine who gave me this advice.
Pardon me.
No. And he, you know how sometimes the student is in a certain place and the teacher intuits it and drops just the right thing on him. So I'm not sure that this advice is going to be as useful, but here's what he said. He said something like this. In bad dialogue, the characters actually answer one another directly. You know, why do you think you're so sad, Misty? Because all my life I felt I wasn't good enough, Rod. You know, so that somehow that the energy just drops. Okay, that's why she's sad. Well, sorry, Misty. Tough shit for you. But what Doug said is in real life we walk around with these thought bubbles. You know, so you're out for coffee with Rod. I don't know, and you're Misty, and you're actually thinking about the fact that your car has a flat tire, and Rod didn't even offer to help. Because Rod's a selfish guy. He always has been. Look at those boots. Oh, he just loves those boots. You know, whatever. So you go on and on. And then Rod says, hey, Misty, how's your day going? And she says, oh, fuck off. You know, I mean, there's some kind of cross-talking that goes on so that these thought bubbles are actually what we're mostly paying attention to. You know how sometimes you're listening to somebody and you've already got your answer made up on sentence three? So he said that is actually why dialogue feels full and lifelike, is when characters are talking to each other from those thought bubbles. And then the corollary is you should always try to make dialogue on the page look like poetry. And read like poetry, down to even the attributions. That's within your power. You can move the attributions around to make the music of it. And then the third thing was abandon the idea that it should sound like real speech. And I think his advice was if you don't believe that, record somebody secretly, and you'll find out that there is no such thing as real speech. And I actually did this. I hid a recorder under my mom's table, and she was talking to my grandmother. And it was just beautiful, but it wasn't real. It was like, hey, could you go get the thing on the, no, the red, the blue, no, the smaller, right, yes. But she didn't, yeah, they will, okay. You know, like that. So I think basically you're freed from any verisimilitude, and your job is to make a poem of the dialogue, something like that, yeah. Yeah, but don't tell anybody beyond this room.
Okay, I think we've got time for one more question. Let's take one from back here. Yeah. If you'd like to come forward, so George can see you.
Hello.
Oh, hello. You have to just keep walking until you. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
That's all right. Hi.
Hello.
Hi there.
So, my question is, do you feel? Just because I, like, recently just read The Brain Dead Megaphone, like, writing just this really nasty I told you so, and just, like, or do you feel this, like, insane sense of, like, self-defeat? Like, if I, with all of the people who read my stuff, how does your writing make a difference? And then the small second question is, just because my friend and I go back and forth on this, where did you decide to use like the capital letters for capital I important nouns in your essay writing?
That one I don't know actually. I think I stole it from A.A. Milne actually. And you know, and I got made fun of for that by a critic, and I've never done it since. So really? The main thing is you have to have integrity. That's, you know, yeah. No, yeah, no. But the first thing, here's what I think. I think as artists, one of the best things we can do is be really realistic about what our work accomplishes. And to do that, we have to think about what writing has done for us. I think if you start thinking, oh, I really want to change the world with my book, it actually makes you kind of a bad practitioner, because as we said earlier, that's not really the way the machine works. So I take a lot of comfort in individual reading experiences I had. When I was young, my wife had a fellowship with Toni Morrison, and I had never read The Bluest Eye. So I read The Bluest Eye, and it blew my mind. And the reason, and what it did actually was, it reminded me of a way I used to feel as a young Catholic kid at about 6 or 7, 8 years old. I don't know why the book did that. I really don't know. But it restored a vision of compassionate action into my mind. The idea that actually it is possible to imagine someone else's experience, and actually that the the most powerful position in the world, if you could do it, would be to have completely unbounded love for everybody. Now, I don't mean in a kind of a New Agey way, but if you, the kind of love that Toni Morrison had for her characters in that book, if you could carry that around and have that every day, you would never be afraid of anything. You would never be at a loss for what to do. So she did that to me, and that was something that clicked in my head. It was super strong for about 3 days. I went back and read the book and marked it up so I could technically figure out what I could from it. So the buzz, the big buzz, tapered off after about a week, but there was some turning of my mind that never has gone back. So I know from experience that can happen. Now, does that mean that there's be no suffering in the world? It never has, you know, it never has. But incrementally, every one of us can be a little, can actually feel that we're more alive and we're more, you know. So I'm afraid, it's a little bit like that old cheesy thing about the guys walking along the beach throwing
the starfish.
Some kind of, yeah, starfish, yeah, throwing the starfish back in, and someone says, well, what good does that do? Nobody cares about that. And he goes, well, this starfish did, and throws it in. So I think if we keep a realistic idea of art by remembering what it's done for us, then everything is proportioned correctly, and we don't have to despair if it doesn't. You know, if suffering continues, well, all the great spiritual beings have told us that it will. And so I think there's comfort, and I take a lot of comfort in that, actually.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
On which note, please do stick around. We're going to be serving wine. The evening is not over. I don't think I need to tell you how remarkable this book is, but I should stress it is a truly extraordinary reading experience. I do press it upon you. Thankfully, we have stacks and stacks of them at the till. I'm sure George would be delighted to sign some of them for you. We also have all of George's backlist as well. So all that remains for me to say, afterwards as well, Graham will be around with his VR. Please do check it out. It is something quite remarkable. First of all, I do want to thank Word for Word again. Can we just hear it for them one more time? That was truly remarkable. Thank you so much. And for one more time tonight, please give it up for George Saunders.
Thank you very much. And can I just say one last thing? This book, as I said at the beginning, this book was really a stretch for me, and I promise you that one way that I was able to do it was nights like this, where during this conversation and also after as we're talking, you see what good-hearted people your readers are and how much they actually want you to take a chance and succeed. So thank you very, very much for all the years of support.